Caroline Hines. Welcome to a new episode of Caroline Talks. This is the podcast/YouTube channel where I speak to film creators about around the world about their work, the industry, and what inspires them. And today, I'm very happy to be joined by filmmaker Suloko Keiko to talk about her 2023 film, Sugaru Laka Girl, which is showing here at the 2024 Toronto Japanese Film Festival. And I'm very happy to be joined by her. So Sugaru Laka Girl is about this young woman who is kind of feeling lost in life, but she has a wish to take over her father's lacquerware business. So Sugaru Noodle is a type of Japanese traditional lacquerware, and it's normally passed off from father to son, but she wants to inherit the business. So it's about her finding her way as a businesswoman, but also finding the confidence to pursue her dream as a Sugaru Noodle lacquerware craftsman. Director Keiko, can you talk to me about coming up with the idea of adapting Sugaru Lacquerware Girl, because it's actually based on a manga?
どうしてこれを映画化しようとしたんですか？元のは漫画かな？原作？
小説ですね。小説が原作でそれを映画化しようという企画です。
This is actually not manga, it's a novel, most original.
So it's not a manga.
No,
I thought it was based on a manga. No wonder I couldn't find any information. So what made you decide to adapt the novel into a film?
Why did you want to adapt this novel into a film? Why did you want to adapt the novel into a film? Why did you want
to adapt the novel into a film? Why did you want to adapt the novel into a film? Why did you want to adapt the novel into a film? Why did you want to adapt the novel into a film? Why did you20代半ばの女の子が自分の道を見つけていくというプロットがすごくその時私がやりたかったことにフィットしたので、やりますっていうことにお返事しました。
So the novel is about a story about, like, you know, craftsmanship and creating stuff, but also it's a story of a young mid-20s womanfind a way she wants to do, and that's a plot that her director Tsuroka wanted to do. So when she heard the story, she said she wants to make the movie.
Is what inspired you to create the film, because it's based on a young woman, Miyako Aoki. Is it that you yourself, as a young creative and as a filmmaker, felt connected to the character and you wanted to bring her story to life on screen?
どうしてこのストーリーに興味を持ったのですか？このストーリー自体は若い女性が、やりたいことを見つけるということで、監督自身も若い女性だと思いますので、何かそういう関係性はあったのでしょうか？
そうですね、私は割と自分がやりたいことをしっかり見つけて、それをこう実現できているタイプの人間なんですけど、例えば私のこう地元とか日本広く見たときに、地方で暮らしている女性たちにはなかなかこうそういうふうに自分が本心でやりたいことっていうのを実現できている人はそんなに多くはないんじゃないかっていうことを考えていた時期だったので、そういう人たちにちょっとスポットを当てて物語にしたいと思ったんですね。
I myself is someone that I found something that I want to do and then made it to a real. However, I know that especially in the countryside, there are a lot of women who can't really follow their dream, like they can't really do something they really want to.And I was thinking about those situations at the time, so I wanted to put the spotlight on this kind of character.
Yes, because in the film there's kind of a theme of Miyako being told that her brother should be the person to take over the business, because it's assumed, because he's the son and he's male, that he should pursue this particular form of craftsmanship, while her only pursuit should be to get married and have children, which is something that's very common around the world. Girls aren't really encouraged to pursue their dreams.
そうですね。この主人公は、例えばお兄さんの方が、 そのビジネスをテイクオーバーした方がいいんじゃないかみたいなのやっぱそれは なぜかだったら男だし、うん、息子だしあのそういう伝統的にあの次の世代は、まあ、男が引き継ぐっていうようになってるんですけれども、まあ、実際に世界中を見ても女性は結婚して子供を産まなきゃいけないっていうようなあのところがすごく多いと思います、
うん、そうですね、まあ、本当に日本はみんな無意識のうちにそういう意識があるというか男の人が信頼されるっていうものがまだ結構色濃く残ってると思いますし、まあ、女性がこう自分がやりたいことをやりながら今おっしゃったようにその結婚をして出産をして子育てをするみたいなことのこう道の作り方の難しさみたいなのがやっぱ社会の問題になっているので、それはこの映画の中でもはっきりとした明確としたビジョンは持っててはいないんですけど、まあ今みんなが考えなきゃいけない共通の問題としてテーマにしたという部分はあります。
In Japan, I think a lot of people have this idea, like subconsciously, that men are more trustworthy. However, for women, it's so hard to like get married and have kids by doing whatever they want to do. I think it's like a sort of a social issue. And in this film, we don't really like clearly mention this. However, this is something that everybody should be thinking of.
Because I thought it was interesting, whereas Miyako's mom would tell her, oh, you don't, she was kind of saying she's not smart enough to pursue whatever she wanted to, like when she was younger, she wanted to play piano, her mom was like, oh, you're not smart enough to do this, and then when she said she wanted to do Sugaru, her mom said, you're also not smart enough to do this.
そうですね、お母さんからもそういうちょっと反対みたいなのされますよね。彼女はあの例えばピアノやりたいって言った時もあなたは賢くないとか、うん、つばるの料理だって言った時もそういうことをお母さんから言われたりしますね。
そうですね、あのお母さんっていうのはそういうのをはっきりと言うキャラクターとして登場させてるんですけど、多分お母さん、まあ、同性であるお母さんがあえてそういうことを言うっていうのをこう意外に思うかもしれないんですけど、多分あのお母さん自身が社会的にいろんなこう抑圧を受けてきたから自分の中にいろんな固定概念というかこだわりを持ってしまっていて、それを娘に押し付けてしまっているというキャラクターとして描きました。
So you may find it like a kind of strange that you know, mother who is the same sex as Miyako actually tells her things like that. However, she's also like a person that are, when she was growing up, she was like, has been oppressed by the society, and she ended up like having this fixed idea, and like she forces that idea to her daughter. So I made a mother character like that.
And what also I think is an interesting contrast to the mother is her mom is telling her that,but her father, he's not really telling her anything, which is interesting because they both work together. Miyako and her dad sit down and they do their career together. She's learning from him and he's subconsciously teaching her. He's not realizing he's teaching her, but even though he's watching her make the work with him, he doesn't, the idea in his head doesn't come in for her to inherit the company.
まあ逆まあ、コントラストでお父さんはあんまり何も言わないキャラクターです。でそれは面白いと思いました。で彼は実際にあの彼女に津軽にリリートをしているんですけども、 So what was your last comment?
That even though he's watching her and he's teaching her subconsciously, the idea never occurs to him to actually let her take over the business. He's just letting her do it, but he still expects the brother to take over the business even though the brother isn't learning from him
ただなんか宮子に教えてはいるけれども、あの実際のところはなんか息子が継ぐんだろうと思ってるっていうところもありますね、
う
ん、
そうですそうです、あの作業は一緒に娘とお父さんでやるんですけど、あそこでのまだお父さんの中の考え方としてはアシスタントなんですよ、あの手伝いみたいな感じでやらせていて、自分が こう苦労して続けてきた道を任せられるのは息子だっていうふうに彼も思い込んでしまっているので、それが娘だっていうふうに彼は想像したことがないので、まあ、この物語を通じてそのお父さんの考えが息子から娘にシフトしていくという工程があまりこうセリフでは描かれないんですけど、なんとなくそういう流れは作っています。
Yes, you're right. He teaches her and then they work together. However, he considered her as only assistant.
Mm-hmm.
And because he had her ship learning this craftsmanship, and then his idea was like only the son can he could rely on in the end. He never thought that his daughter can do this. However, in the story, like his idea changes from son to daughter. So it's not maybe clearly mentioned in the script, but that was the idea behind it.
Mm-hmm, right. I think for this film, it's very interesting. Like you mentioned the script just now. There is not much dialogue in this film. I think a lot of everything that the audience is told comes through the actions of the characters. Like for Miyako, her evolution is shown to us. She starts out very shy and she becomes more confident, but her confidence comes through doing the lacquerware. Like she did the piano, she made this beautiful piano, and her confidence comes through making that piano. Can you talk about, because the film doesn't have much dialogue, about crafting her progression as a character through her actions and especially through making the piano?
まあ、この映画はあんまり会話がないくて、そのアクションで見せるものが多かったと思います。
はい、
で、特に美和子さんがこう進化していく様が、最初は結構シャイなキャラクターなのに、だんだんこう自信をつけていきますよね。で、特にこうニューヨークができるようになることで自信もついていきます。で、最後にこうピアノを作るということで、本当に自信がついたと思います。
はい、そうですね。まあ、もともと日本人はそんなにこうコミュニケーションに長けた人間たちではないっていうのもありますし、まあ、特に、青森の、まあ、方たちは寡黙で黙々と手作業をするみたいなタイプの人たちがやっぱり多いし、その今回のキャラクターたちもそれをちょっとこうすごくこう強めるというか、そのキャラクターたちの個性としてあまり喋らないけれども手を動かすのは好きで、やっぱりその手を動かすことによって彼らが何をこう思っているのかとかがこう観客に伝わるようにっていうのはこちらも狙いとしてあったので、そういう構成になってますね。
Yes, Japanese people are probably not so good at communication、mm-hmm.And also, especially people in Aomori, they tend to be very quiet, and they use their hands, but just not talking too much. Mm. So I made those characters with those like very strong characters, and so they don't talk too much. However, by looking at how they move their hands, the audience can understand what they're thinking.
Mm-hmm.I noticed that with the film. The film is very, it's not slow paced, but it feels very patient. And I get the sense that you match the tone of the film to the craftsmanship they use in making the lacquerware, because it's a very slow process. It uses a lot of technique and a lot of patience. And I felt like you let that guide you in crafting the tone and the pace of the film.
そうですね、この映画はなんか遅いというよりもすごく辛抱強いものだと思いました。で、ノリ自体もそのクラフトマンシップとして時間がとてもかかって、で技術はとてもいるんだけれども辛抱もすごくいると思います。やっぱりそういうっていう風なところを映画で描きたかったのでしょうか。
そうですね、おっしゃる通りで、こう津軽塗りって塗る工程ももちろんたくさんあって大変なんですけど、それを漆風呂っていうんですけど、こう棚に入れてしっかりそれが固まるまで待つっていう工程がすごく大事で、その時間と時間をこう利用して作られていくんですけど、待つっていうのが この映画にとっては結構キーワードで、まあ、今本当にそういう待つみたいなことが行われないすごくせわしない、社会に日本は特になってるんですけど、その中で少しこう、こういう時間も大事だよねということを伝えたいっていうのもあって、そういう辛抱強いという言葉に表現されるようなことも入れたいと思いました。
Yes, as you mentioned, lacquer takes a lot of process, and especially one of the very important processes, you put the lacquer on the shelf and you have to wait until it solidifies. That takes a long time. So actually waiting is sort of like a keyword of this film. Because Japanese society became like, you know, non-patient, just like everything is very quick. However, spending time can be important, so that's why I wanted to tell the audience, like, just the patience.
Mm. And as a director, how challenging was that for you? Because I imagine you also had to learn the process of lacquering to be able to film it and figure out how you wanted the film to go, but also working with your actors and like the main actors, Hota Mayu and Kobayashi Kaoru, who plays her father, like they had to essentially learn the craft. So how challenging was it for you as a filmmaker to learn that particular type of patience to film it, but also to make sure your cast had the techniques now to film it?
そうですね。監督はこのつがる塗りを学ばないといけなかったと思います。でまた俳優さんたちもつがる塗りのやり方を学ばない方いったらいけないと思います、まあ、小林薫さんと堀田真由さんで、まあ、監督自身もそのつがる塗りを学ぶということに困難があったと思いますけども、特に俳優さんたちに学んでもらうということでどういう困難がありましたか？難しさ、
彼らはすごく普段忙しいので、あんまり準備の期間がもらえなかったんですね。なのでもう本当に現場の直前、撮影の直前に職人さんに見せてもらって少しだけ練習をして、であとはもう現場で実際に目の前で、その塗りのやり方を教えてもらいながらそれを再現するっていう方法で撮っていったので、まあ、最初はやっぱり戸惑いながらやってたんですけど、だんだんその映画の中でもだんだん上手になってくるんですけど、まあ、あと一つ私もそうだし俳優さんたちも大変だったのが、漆ってかぶれてしまうんですね。その触るとかぶれてしまうので、それは本当に大変でした。私もロケハンの時からかぶれて皮膚科にかかって薬を飲みながらやってました。
The actors are especially busy and they don't have enough prep time, so like they just before the shooting, and they quickly have to learn, you know, how to do it by watching the actual artist making it, and then they have like a little bit of time to practice, and also during the shoot, artists come and then they do in front of the actor, and the actor basically mimic what the artist is doing. And at first, you know, they're like kind of like don't know how to do, but then eventually like they kind of learned, same as the film. But also another problem of a lacquer is like that you can get like rash or itches came from the lacquer. So for her, even from like a location hunting, she get like all this like, you know, skin problem, and then she had to go see dermatologist and
I watched a few documentaries about lacquerware and the process, and it uses a lot of different techniques, which I guess could be kind of rough on the skin. And I wanted to ask you about the piano in particular. So I thought that the piano was an interesting item to have, because a theme in the film is sustainability and passing on traditions. And it made me think of how for a lot of the craft, the older generation, the craftsmen, they're worried about passing it on to future generations. And I thought, oh, sustainability means also adaptability.
それは、まあ、私もドキュメンタリーでちょっとこうやってどうやってラッカーが作る、漆が作られるのかっていうのを見たことあるんですけれども、まあ、この映画の中では特にピアノのシーンが面白いと思いました。で、テーマとしては例えばサステナビリティとか伝統というところがあると思うんですけれども、So yeah, I didn't really understand the last question.
And because they have to adapt, they have to find new ways to make lacquerware appeal to modern day consumers. So for instance, the piano, and they also have to use like new brighter color techniques. So in the documentaries I watched, they're using it for microwavable bento boxes. They're using more modern materials but still traditional techniques. So I thought the film was an interesting way to say to have the tradition stay alive, the craftsmen need to adapt. And that also means passing on to female craftsmen and not just sons. It has to be new materials but also new craftsmen as well, or craftswomen.
で、まあ、新しい消費者にこう受け入れるためにも、まあ、例えば新しい色を開発したりとか、うん、電子レンジに使えるようなものを開発したりとかしてると思うんですけれども、まあ、その職人側も変化に対応しないといけないということですね。まあ、化粧品開発もそうだし、まあ、女性にの職人さんが出てくるということも、まあ、時代の流れに乗ってるというか、まあ、変化に対応しているということだと思います。
そうですね、実際今女性の職人さんがとても増えていて、実際のその仕事の内容的には女性向きというか、そんなに肉体的にハードな仕事ではないので、女性の職人さんがすごく増えているし、そうです、おっしゃる通り、こう日本の食文化とか食卓のそのデザインみたいなものもどんどん変わってきているので、それに寄り添う形の塗りみたいなものを皆さん今考えようとしていろいろ試行錯誤されているし、これも
デザリア、I was wondering.
これも津軽塗りなんですけど、こういうアクセサリーとか身につけるものとしてもみんな活用したりしてますね。劇中でピアノを塗ってるのはその大きなものを塗る機械っていうのがどんどんなくなってるっていうのも現実的にあって、昔はこうテーブルとかを塗ってたんですけど、そういうのを塗る機械がどんどんなくなっているので、まあ、ピアノというものでちょっとこう大きなチャレンジをするみたいな意味合いも込めてピアノを塗ってます。
Yes, however in Japan the women, female artists are increasing because I think the making lacquer is actually good for women because it's not too physical、but also like Japanese lifestyle and also like the eating style is changing, so also those artists are thinking about like how to change the designs that are adapting to the current the style and the culture, but also the in terms of piano, that's something like it's a big furniture. And the lacquer industry, they had more chance of working on a bigger furniture, for example, like a table. But those kind of chances are decreasing, so there's less chance of like working on the big stuff. So her trying on the piano is actually like her challenge of working on the big material.
I thought the piano was interesting because I love the way it was tied into playing the piano for her, because it tied into her wish of learning to play the piano. But she may not be able to play piano, but she gets to make it beautiful again. So I thought that was a beautiful way of tying in her past dream to her present dream. And so I want to ask you another question about adaptability, especially with regards to the
brotherhood. So, 例えばもう弾くことはできないけれども美しく蘇らせることができた、で、なんか過去と今の What's that? What did you say about past?
It was a way, it was, I thought it was a beautiful way of tying her past dream when she was younger learning to play piano.
Yeah.
Okay.
ピアノを弾きたかったって
過去の夢につながっていくんじゃないかと。
はいはい、そうですね、そういう意味合いを物語的には込めてますね。
And so my final question, I think the like for the themes, one of the other words I would say to describe the film, apart from patience and sustainability and adaptability, is adaptability being with regards to the culture changing. Like the brother, he's gay, and like there's a segment that Miyako watches talking about one of the prefectures introducing a new law for gay rights. So I thought it was another way that the film talked about the society learning to adapt to modern ways of thinking.
でまあ、この映画のキーワードとして例えばその辛抱強さとかサステナビリティとかあとの変化についていくというところなんですけれども、文化だけではなくて、まあ、やっぱ兄弟がゲイというところが出てきます。で映画の中でもそのケンがまあ、ゲイをまあ、アクセプトするような法律ができるというところで、社会自体も変化についていかなければいけないというところが、まあ、映画の一つのテーマなのかなと思いました。
そうですね、それがこう無理やりこう変化を強要するのではなくて、こうじわっと穏やかに行われていけばいいなというなんとなく私の中にあるビジョンを、まあ、映画で表現したという感じですね。
Yes, and then also the kind of adaptability, it's not something that it should be forced、mm-hmm. but that's something that are like slowly happening、peacefully.That's sort of my vision, and I wanted to depict that、mm-hmm. in my film.
Slowly and peacefully, like making that work. Thank you so much for taking、
Thank、
the time、
you.
for speaking with me. It was such a pleasure. Thank you so much. Thank you for
Thank
the
you.
Invitation. So everyone, this was another interview that I did for my podcast.YouTube channel, Sir Karen Talks. And in this episode, I interviewed director Keiko Tsuruoka for her film Tsugaru Lacquer Girl. And that was a great film. Thank you so much to my interpreter, Aki Takabatake, who is the CEO and founder of Momo Films Inc., which will be linked in the description box. So Momo Films is a boutique independent film and distribution company. And I've interviewed Aki before. I interviewed her last year for the festival because she is one of the distributors for the films for the Toronto Japanese Film Festival. So I'm always appreciative of her taking the time to interpret my interviews for me. And I appreciate so much director Tsuruoka for her time. And she was really fun to talk to. If you noticed, like her voice is very soft.And she speaks very softly, but she's so fun. And it was great to talk to her. And this may sound like a silly anecdote, but it actually meant a lot to me. Like, she's short. And it was just like, oh, so I got to interview filmmakers as short as I am. But it was great to talk to her. And like, I loved all the films that I saw at the festival. Tsugaru Lacquer Girl is not only, I think, a great film about young women, like achieving their dreams and going forward to achieve their dreams despite whatever anyone says. But I think it's also really good.Insight into the work of Tsugaru Nuri, which is a traditional Japanese lacquerware craft. And like, if you've seen them on film, you've seen them everywhere, like those little black boxes with like the gold and all these pretty designs on them. And the film takes a really, I think, a really in-depth look at that from an artistic perspective. So I really like those aspects of the film. And you can see other interviews that I did for the film from Match on my YouTube channel. That's tutu.com/Carolyn_Hines, and as well as interviews that I did for the Short Shorts Film Festival in Asia. That will be in the K-Crush America Magazine playlist on the channel, but you can also go to the official K-Crush website, that's kcrush.com, for those interviews that I've done, as well as those for like the Jeonju International Film Festival. And all of my other interviews and podcasts, you'll find linked in my channel, as well as on my R3 page. That's my digital portfolio. That's r3.com. That's AUTHORY.com/Carolyn Hines. You'll find all my written work there, podcasts, YouTube episodes, everything there. Follow me on Instagram and Twitter at CarrieCNH12. And if you want to donate to my work as a freelance film culture critic, please, I would greatly appreciate it, because a girl has been struggling in these streets this year. It has not been easy for us. International freelance film critics, especially those who are like me, women. I'm just being honest, like it's like been very hard for us. So my PayPal is linked in the description box for the YouTube channel, as well as the podcast. And I've been having a really great time interviewing filmmakers this year. And even though my YouTube channel is not monetized, I don't have enough followers. I appreciate everyone that follows me, but I'm having such a great time. And each interview that I do that goes extremely well, and all the feedback that I get from everyone really does affirm for me that, you know, I'm doing the right thing. The work that I'm doing matters. And the most important thing is that I am having fun doing it as well. And I appreciate everyone who tells me that they love my interviews. And to everyone who follows me, everyone who supports me, thank you so, so much. I really appreciate it. You really have no idea how much it means to me. Until the next episode of Carolyn Talks, everyone, stay safe. Bye.